following subject matter is real and only intended for mature audiences. Discretion is advised.
People are dead after deputies say a man went on a shooting rampage.
I knew a week before she died I was going to kill her.
I can tell you the scene out there is absolutely horrific.
Nobody knows where this individual may strike next.
This is 10 Minute Murder.
Hi, I'm Joe, I'm the host, and thank you for joining today. And I hope you're staying safe out there with this new Omicron variant that just dropped. What? Omicron? That doesn't sound right, but okay. Apparently it's Omicron, not Omicron. Hey, if today's your first time listening to this brief and bingeable true crime podcast, first of all, welcome, and take a look at where you're listening right now and subscribe so that you don't miss any future episodes of 10 Minute Murder. If when you listen today and one of your friends pops into your head and you think, hey, they might like this podcast, then by all means, please tell them about it. In the new year, I plan to have shirts, stickers, and all that kind of stuff printed up. And the holdup up until now has been, I can't decide if I like the logo of 10 Minute Murder enough to pay to have a bunch of stuff made up. And I'm not offending a graphic artist out there because I was the graphic artist that created it. And I'm hurting my own feelings here. I made the logo myself and I'm always overly critical of my own work. So hopefully, if I can get over my own overthinking, I'll start sending out 10-minute murder stuff. And by the way, this is a new microphone that I'm using in case my voice sounds a little bit different today. I haven't heard it up until now. I'm testing it out. It just came in. So if I sound a little bit different than normal, that's the reason. And on occasion, people do ask me what gear I use, what microphones I use, and that kind of thing. And if you don't know anything about microphones, this is about to sound like a different language to you, but this microphone I'm talking into right now is a Neumann TLM-103, and I usually use a Sennheiser MKH-416. I have used an Electro Voice RE-320. I have that right beside me. I've used a Rode NT-1 and a Shure SM-7B. In case it wasn't obvious, I like microphones and I buy more than I should. Okay, you didn't come here to listen to me talk about stickers and microphones, so let's get to today's story. By the late 1980s, over 40 dead bodies had turned up in Rostov, Russia, all killed and mutilated in the same way, as authorities were sure that the person responsible would continue killing until caught. They were desperate to find him. According to the initial profile of the killer, they were looking for a younger man, likely in his 30s, probably a grifter. As a result, no one was looking for someone in their 50s, a former military man and father of two. Someone like Andre Chikatilo. Andre Romanovich Chikatilo was born on October 16, 1936, in a small Ukrainian village in the USSR that I can't pronounce. Back then, Ukraine was still going through the aftermath of a man-made famine engineered by the Soviet dictator Joseph Stalin to exterminate the Ukrainians. His policies eventually resulted in the loss of almost 4 million innocent lives, and people even resorting to cannibalism to survive. Andre lived with his parents, who were both farm laborers, in a one-room hut. Throughout his childhood, Andre's mother, Anna, repeatedly told him that he actually had an older brother who had been kidnapped and eaten by neighbors during the high peaks of famine. While the claim was never verified and no documentation has been found of Andre's alleged brother, the story burned on the young man's mind and followed him all the way to adulthood. In addition to external hardships, Andre suffered from hydrocephalus, which means water on the brain. The condition caused him a series of problems, including bedwetting, which was especially humiliating for Andre because he slept in the same bed as his parents in their one-room hut. Even though their son could not help his condition, Anna sometimes beat Andre for it. Another issue caused by hydrocephalus was Andre's inability to sustain an erection. However, at this point in his life, that was the least of Andre's problems. Around the early 1940s, the Nazis occupied Ukraine, causing young Andre to live in a constant fear. On top of that, his father was captured during the war, held prisoner, and later branded a coward by his own countrymen when he finally returned home. Afterward, Andre was often bullied for being a son of a person who let himself get caught. It's not really strange that Andre later developed a twisted interest in stories about German prisoners being tortured by their Soviet army during World War II. A healthier coping mechanism would have been nice, but that's not what he was dealing with. After graduating from public school, Andre tried to enroll at Moscow State University, but didn't get in because his grades were too low. So instead, Andre completed his military service before returning to his native village. There, Andre met a young woman, but after just 3 months together, their relationship ended due to his incompetence in bed. As if that was not hurtful enough, rumors about Andre's impotence soon spread around town, leading to more ridicule. The final straw for Andre, as he said in a 1993 interview, quote, "Girls were going behind my back, whispering that I was impotent. I was so ashamed. I tried to hang myself. My mother and some young neighbors pulled me out of the noose. Well, I thought no one would want such a shamed man. So I had to run away from there, away from my homeland." And so, still alive, Andre found a job as a communications engineer in a town located north of Rostov on Don. He rented a small apartment close to his workplace, where his younger sister, Tatiana, moved in too. She soon expressed her concern about Andre's lack of success with the opposite sex. So to do something about it, Tatiana arranged a meeting with a woman that she knew of named Fedosia, and a last name I can't pronounce. Her plan worked out very well. Fantastic, actually. Andre and Fedosia got married in 1963. Despite his sexual problems, the two eventually were able to have two children and lived an outwardly normal family life. However, in 1971, Andre began showing signs of his dark side. A very dark side. He had ended up completing a degree in Russian literature and philosophy, and soon obtained a job as a teacher. First of all, Andre was not really good at his new job, but he had also begun to assault the young children. This behavior eventually forced him to move from school to school before his career as a teacher finally ended in March 1981, after several complaints of child molestation against pupils of both sexes. However, Andre was never legally punished for these actions, and he was free to continue doing whatever he pleased. Disturbingly, by the time he was fired from his teaching job, Andre was not just a child molester, but a murderer. We don't know for sure when Andre Chikatilo killed his first victim, all because it seems that another man was arrested, convicted, and executed for it. Still, it's widely believed that he was responsible for the murder of a 9-year-old named Yelena in September of 1978. She had been strangled and stabbed several times. Curiously, though, Yelena's blood was found near Andre's home and her backpack on the riverbank at the end of the street. A witness had also seen a man who looked a lot like Andre with the girl at a bus stop shortly before her death. Still, another man with a history of a similar crime took the fall instead, despite having an airtight alibi. Perhaps Yelena's murder, if Andre was really the one to have done it, gave him a feeling as if it was easy to get away with, because after the other guy was convicted, bodies began to appear out of nowhere. Most of Andre's victims were transients, children, or runaways who no one would miss, at least not very soon. He would pick them up at a bus stop or a train station, giving them all the same treatment. Andre would stab and slash his victims to death, which he said was the only way he could reach orgasm at this point in his life. He would occasionally mutilate their bodies with his teeth and eat the sex organs or removed other body parts such as the tips of their noses or tongues. In addition, Andre would often gouge the victim's eyes out before covering them with leaves and dirt. Andre later rationalized removing the eyes of his victims, saying he was afraid his image would be imprinted on the eyes and his identity could have been found through them. Makes perfect sense. Andre Chikatilo was able to continue his killing spree for more than 10 years. However, he had actually been arrested once in September 1984 as two undercover detectives had seen him talking to a young woman at a Rostov bus station, where they believed the killer was searching for victims. But Andre was eventually released, and for the weirdest reason. During the investigation, the police had found that Andre's blood type did not match the semen sample they had taken from a victim. However, at the time, it was not known Andre was a so-called non-secretor, meaning that his blood type was different from those of his bodily fluids. Nevertheless, Andre was released, and he would continue his murderous ways for another 6 years. Finally, in 1990, after 6 days of surveillance, Andre was arrested again on November 20th. As the detectives did not have any luck while questioning him, psychiatrist Dr. Bukanovsky entered the interrogation. He had a different approach which immediately worked wonders. The doctor let Andre believe he was more interested in understanding the mind of a serial killer, which flattered Andre and made him open up. In the end, Andre confessed to 56 murders, of which 53 were later confirmed. On April 14, 1992, he was brought to trial, which was the first major media event of post-Soviet Russia. Russian press began to immediately publish exaggerated and sensationalized headlines about the murders, calling Andrei a shaven skull demonic individual. Throughout the trial, Andrei was held in an iron cage designed to keep him apart from the relatives of his many victims. His behavior ranged from bored to manic, singing and talking gibberish to not wanting to speak at all for 3 days. The judge of the case was clearly biased, saying Andrei's guilt was a foregone conclusion from the start. However, it took over 2 months to announce the verdict after the trial ended. Finally, on October 15, 1992, Andrei was found guilty on 52 of the 53 murder charges. He was sentenced to death. The judge noted it was, quote, the only sentence that he deserves. Andrei's defense tried to make an appeal that he had not been fit to stand trial in the first place because of his psychiatric evaluation, but the attempt was unsuccessful. 16 months later, on Valentine's Day of 1994, Andrei Chikatilo was executed by a shot to the back of the head in a Moscow prison. Since then, Dr. Bukhanovsky, who we can thank for even knowing about the extent of Andrei's crimes, has talked with and treated over 30 serial killers. According to him, serial killers don't want to kill in the first place, but have an urge built up inside them from childhood until they can't control it anymore. It's a controversial view that the doctor named the Chikatilo phenomenon. Quote, many think that serial killers get pleasure from killing. This is not so. Their urge to kill is like breathing. It's irresistible. They want to desperately stop. Some are even relieved when they are finally caught. Still, we can all agree, it took way too long to stop the butcher of Rostov. That's today's 10-Minute Murder, brief and bingeable true crime. Thanks for listening today. And by the way, during the course of me researching this case and looking up different facts about the Andrei Chikatilo, and don't ask me how, because this is completely insane, but I came across this video that has absolutely nothing to do with Andrei Chikatilo. But someone in an online video called Shoes, Feet Prisons. All serious, no jokes. You're wearing the wrong shoes if it feels like your feet are in a prison. I personally have shoes that aren't the most comfortable, but you know what I do? I don't wear those shoes. Feet prison. Calm down. And I don't even think it has anything to do with the Andrei Chikatilo. I don't know how I got to that video, but it happened. Before you scoot out of here, make sure you are connected with 10 Minute Murder on social media. The links are in the show notes of this episode, or just go to Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, type in 10 Minute Murder, and it'll pop right up. Thanks for listening to 10 Minute Murder. Stay safe and have a good night.